Thank you, Ashim. I think that what Raminder has started by speaking about the right of workers to live in the city, and that is what we will be discussing as well. I mean, the first question that comes up is, why are we discussing only Mumbai and Delhi? But the fact is that most of these policies actually get made in struggles or as part of policy in Delhi and Bombay, and then gets extended in different parts of the country. Now, many things that we have been fighting against in Mumbai, we are seeing it being not only promoted, but people are also accepting that as good policy because they have not understood all the implications of that policy, because we don't share enough of our experiences. And particularly with regard to workers' housing, what the experience that Raminder has placed, and this is not the only experiences that we have in this are only in Mumbai and Delhi, but all over the country, there are so many different kinds of rich variety of experiences which we really need to discuss with each other. So I'm glad we have this session, not because it is very much part of the labor movement. And I think this also links with the fact that jobs are being lost, and the reason for jobs being lost may be many. It's closure, it is the fact that there is mechanization, there is artificial intelligence, there is the whole changes in the economy that makes the only jobs available as so menial that many people who have been educated, I mean, a worker who is working in a brick kiln wants to educate his or her children in order to become a little better. But by the time they do that, the jobs at that level have already disappeared. And this is happening everywhere. And so if this is going to happen, so that we come to this peculiar situation where we are, the unions are not just having to fight for wages and emoluments and working conditions, but for the rights of workers who are not working. And this is become a very important job of trade unions everywhere. So whether you are working or not, you require social protection, you require services, access to basic services. This, whether it is like the right to breathe. If you're living, you have to breathe. If you're living, you need a house, you need food, you need shelter, you need a sustainable environment in which to live, and you need health, education, and other kinds of public services. And this has to be made available. And this, I'm saying, because this was one of the debates that we had when we took up the whole social protection with Baba and others in the Working People's Charter. When there was a debate, why are we not just demanding jobs? Because if struggles are only in a framework-oriented fashion, if you look at struggles only in a framework-oriented fashion and not in a constituency-oriented fashion, what we come to is, we have a right to jobs, we should get jobs, without looking at the fact that, okay, yes, everybody should have jobs, but what if you don't get jobs? What are we going to do if we don't have jobs? So this is actually one of the learnings from the Mumbai struggle as well, and I think to some extent what Raminder also talked about was that we do need to look at we cannot only demand jobs and minimum wage and wages, we do need to demand all the other things that are necessary to sustain life of the workers and their families. Okay, the second thing that I want to say is the question of dignity, and I think one of the good things that have come out of our 2 days discussions is how central the issue of dignity is. A worker who has a job, is earning, has a certain dignity. A worker who has lost his or her job or does not manage to get a job, there is a loss of dignity. And I think one of the first things, and we started working with the workers of closed mills, was ki hamare ghar mein koi shaadi nahi karega, shaadi ka rishta nahi hoti. And then this is something that we might consider, who cares? I mean, is that the most important thing? But it is, because nobody will marry your children. And so that is a loss of dignity which workers who have enjoyed a certain level of respect in society, especially in a city like Mumbai, which Mumbai is always been, was, I don't say always been because it is not anymore in my opinion, it was an industrial city. Workers were very much the backbone of the city. In fact, the role of textile workers in the city has been one of actually building the city. They are the first, they are not the first migrants. The first migrants were perhaps the big lot, I mean the big wave of migrants, the second big wave of migrants, you could say. to come and work in the mills. Nobody was willing to come and work in Mumbai because Mumbai was considered a sickly city where people did not last for more than 10 years before they got malaria and died. So the jobbers went into the villages and, you know, kind of caught the workers and brought them here. Houses were provided in order to attract them into the city, and they were put up there. And then when in 1982, when the big strike happened, there were 50 mills employing about 2.5 lakh workers and their families. So you have, and this area covers 600 acres in the middle of Mumbai city, which today is Parel, Lalbagh, etc., where all the big offices are, which is prime real estate. Okay, so now to go back to the to an introduction to the textile workers, if you may, for those who may not know, who may not be from Mumbai, because Mumbai people know this, that textile, or those who are in the trade union movement also know this, that textile workers were the first to form a union. They were the first industrial workers. They were the first to form a union. So the first union was actually set up by a social reformer called Lokhande. And this was in 1890. And what were the demands? A weekly holiday, 30 minutes off for lunch, and rest after sundown. So these were the demands that Lokhande had taken up. It was a kind of social reformer. These are workers. We need to do something for workers. The other thing, I mean, that's the first union. The first political strike is also attributed, about which famously Lenin has also written about, the 1908 strike for the release of Tilak, who was at that time in jail. He was arrested for sedition. He was sentenced for 6 years. So the workers went on strike. It was a huge, spontaneous struggle, which was a very violent. A lot of people were killed in this, because workers were forced to go back into the factories, which they didn't do. So 15 people were killed in the course of that struggle. This was in 1908. Then there were many other firsts I won't go to, but one very major battle was the one for dearness allowance. So the strike for dearness allowance was for the first time established the right of workers for more salary based not just on what the owners were willing to pay, but according to the rise in prices. So although this first was made available to textile workers, it was then later for all other employees, particularly in the formal sector. Now only the formal sector gets that, but this was one of the things that a strike of the textile workers actually established for all workers. Many of the strikes and struggles of the textile workers established rights for other workers as well. It was not as if the strikes were only, the demands only benefited the textile workers. So it was a labor movement of which all workers thought of themselves as a part. It was also the place where the first biggest left union, where Dange was the accepted leader of the textile workers of Mumbai. It was 1928, who was talking about 1931, the discussion on the demands. That was actually a response to 1929 strike, which was organized by the first big strike that was led by the textile workers union. And the textile workers and the leaders of the textile workers were then implicated in conspiracy cases against the British state, because the textile workers were actively involved in the struggle for independence. They were later actively involved in the formation of Sanyukt Maharashtra, where the Hutatma Chowk, where now the Hutatma Chowk stands, where a large number of them were also textile workers. Every single struggle in the city was to a large extent powered, you could say, by the participation of textile workers. So when the textile mills started to close, the support for the textile workers did not come only from the people living in that area called Girangam, where the 50 mills are, but the entire city also was very sympathetic to the struggle. The struggle started soon after the big textile strike. Now the big textile strike, 1982 strike, which you all know about, which is the Guinness Book of for the longest strike, etc. But there is also misconception that that was the reason why the textile mill started to close. But that is not true. It is not because of the textile strike that textile mills started to close. There was already a crisis. Textile sickness was spreading all over. The lack of a proper textile policy, the lack of any kind of interest in protecting what was a totally indigenous industry, which should have been done but was not done, it was disintegrating, but in the midst of that, to conduct a strike and not take it back was a huge tactical error on the part of Tata Samant. That is a fact. And because of that, it broke the back of the textile workers' union, and that was all they had. You see, workers have only their union to depend on. They only have organization to depend on. To break the back of the union, whatever other framework, ideological positions that may be taken, that doesn't help. Again, I wish to point out, and this is not something that we normally say openly, but it is a fact that the reason why Tata Samant did not take the strike back was because of certain left union, which put huge pressure, which was working actively with Tata Samant, which I will say the name, but I will deny that I said it after I leave this room. It was Shramik, which was involved with the. नाम तो मैंने बताया
डीएस को कर
सो दे एक्चुअली पुट ह्यूज प्रेशर ऑन दत्ता सामंत दैट दिस इज गोइंग टू बी द बिगिनिंग ऑफ अ रेवोल्यूशन बिकॉज द वर्कर्स हु हैव नाउ लॉस्ट देयर जॉब्स विल गो बैक टू देयर विलेजेस एंड फ्रॉम द विलेजेस द रेवोल्यूशन विल बिगिन बट देयर वाज अनफॉर्चुनेटली नथिंग ऑफ दैट सॉर्ट हैपेंड बट अनटोल्ड मिजरी of a whole community, because you can imagine that over 600 acres of land, 113 lakh people would be living there. There was nobody. I remember one worker telling me ki it's true, you know, they would collect old newspaper to boil water in order to make tea to drink. Those were, so people had sold everything in the house, including the bartan so. And there are many stories of what happened during that time. I'm not going into that. Most workers also don't talk about that very much because it's considered a black chapter in the life of the textile workers. But you could not even go next door and borrow 2 rupees because everyone in the locality was broke. Nobody had money. Everybody was starving. Nobody could go to the doctor. The city tried very hard to support, and I must say that those who have been around, those who are from Mumbai, they know this, that people collected grains, they collected money, they did everything they could to support the workers, but it was not possible to do this over a year, and the strike broke, and they went back humiliated. They went back with their heads down, and that was what was unforgivable, because you cannot stand on an ideological point that we will never give in. Because even the other day we had an argument about this, that but the point is we never took back the strike. I mean, but you okay, that was very good for your ego, but it was very bad for the textile workers. What needed to be done at that time is aap sar jhukaye aur mazdooron ko jo hai sar uncha karke andar jaane do, yahi hona chahiye tha, lekin wo nahi hua. So the story of the textile workers, the Bandagirini and the textile workers struggle after that, which Datta and I have been associated with, Datta has been the leader of that struggle. It starts after that. Most people will say, "Kyo Datta Samant ke baad to giriniyan band ho gaya, khatam ho gaya na itihas." Lekin actually a news history started after that, where mill workers started a struggle for survival. A new kind of struggle, which they said, we are not going to give up and just die. We are not going to just lie down and give up. We are going to continue the fight. And that's where the work. And most of that I'm going to leave to Datta to talk about. I'm just going to say a few things about what actually, so he doesn't have to go into, Datta hasn't been very well, so I'm just going to, so I'm going to just talk about what we got. So textile, once the textile mill started to close, what textile owners wanted to do was to sell land. So the government was under pressure. But the fact is that all this land, almost 600 acres of land, was actually given to the textile owners in order to run mills. Many of them are on 100-year leases. So now how the government wants to give them the permission, but they know that there's going to be a huge outcry because workers are putting pressure from one side. So what they did at that time, when the struggle started, they said in order to revive the mills, only in order to revive the mills, the owners will get permission to sell the land. Owners are very happy. And the workers of the band mills are also happy because they are getting the mills opened. But what happened was that was only a very short time. Workers got their dues, sure. Workers got their dues. 20,000 workers of 10 mills which did not open after the strike, some of them, some opened and then closed. those mills, which is where the struggle began, the Bandh Girini struggle, that we won, but we lost. Because afterwards what happened was that the closure started in real earnest. The owner started to put pressure saying that we want a complete permission to sell land. Because at that time what was called the... Now the development control regulations are what governs the sale of land, development of land in Mumbai. So under that, so section 58 deals with cotton textile mills. Now it was not allowed to sell cotton textile mills, was not allowed. They amended it so that it can be sold. So then they introduced what's the famous one-third formula. And I wouldn't be surprised if very soon this one-third formula also starts becoming in a few cities elsewhere, where they would share, you know, notes on how to actually give up land which would belong to the city. But this city, this land should actually have reverted to the city. Its leased land should have reverted to the city, which they didn't want to do. And in fact, I must say that you were talking about V.P. Singh. V.P. Singh had come to Mumbai and he told us a very important point, and I think that was a very very significant point that he made, which gave us the rationale for the fight that we conducted after. The fight until then was open the mills, give the jobs back. This was again the very revolutionary left also, which was in the textile industry, were also holding on to that. Mm-hmm. The fact is mills were closing. V.P. Singh said, see, the mill land that was given to them at that time on 1 rupee per square meter, 2 rupees per square meter, if now it has increased in value, how has the mill owner contributed to that value? It is not something that has been contributed by the mill owner. Why should that accrue only to the owner? It should accrue to everybody. And particularly, it should accrue to the workers. Both workers and mill owners have been working on that, in that land. So make sure that that the owners also have a share. We took this up and we said that a share of land should also be. We did not take it up as a main demand, because at that time when we started talking about land, immediately of course there was a backlash saying that if you talk about land, you're giving up your demand to open the mills. So the total demand was still what was being held on to by many of the unions. In fact, when we started talking to the other unions, they said, see, we agree. The other textile union said, we agree, but we cannot take this position because we will be accused of giving up the battle for the opening of the mills. So they wouldn't agree, but we did. We took the step of demanding that land should accrue to workers as well. That demand was finally agreed to. The one-third formula was then amended later. One-third formula meant one-third to the owners, one-third to the city, one-third for public housing. Okay, this was the one-third formula. Now, it looks as if this land has been taken away from mill owners. No. That land was then turned into what's called transferable land rights, you know, TDR, transfer of development rights. This could be taken and piled on other, because there's no land, no? It could be piled on as FSI on other buildings that were being built by the mill owner developers. So no loss was, but they could not build the entire thing in that same, because each mill is 6 acres, 7 acres, 8 acres, 15 acres, each mill. So this was the one-third formula, but so after that, in the 19, as the struggle progressed, the 2001 amendment, there was an amendment in 2001, yes. So I will take only another 5 minutes, I won't even take 10 minutes, yeah. So in response to the struggle, then that was the time when Bilasrao Deshmukh was the chief minister, very straight and honest gentleman. He also had a very straight and honest secretary. His name was Ramanand Tiwari. You know him, of Adarsh fame. So he was the one who actually took up this mill, and he said, so then suddenly we got the mill, the government called the mill workers and said, we are now going to give you all your demands, we are accepting. What are the demands? One, mill chawl tenants will be protected. That was one, because by then we had also created an organization of the mill chawl tenants, because they were also going to be evicted, right? So the mill chawl tenants cannot be evicted. 2, owners who want to close or sell land had to deposit the entire money that was due to the workers in an escrow account, which was monitored by a monitoring committee. It was done also. 3, children of textile workers are given first lien on any commercial enterprise on textile mill. These laws are still in place. Huh? This is the 3rd. 4th, 50% of the 1/3 that has been given for public housing will be for workers' housing, and 1.5, all the workers who are losing their jobs will be provided houses. We accepted this and we started pressing for it. This also created a schism in the textile workers, the one union which was, all the other unions came together, but the one union which did not agree with this, who said that it is a not a good thing, and who then demanded free housing instead, about which Shweta will talk about afterwards. Okay, this is all that I am going to say. So I just want to say one more thing actually. The High Court and Supreme Court, this second thing that I told you, all these things that we got from the government, had one small amendment that was put in by Ramanand Tiwari, who said this will apply only to the land that is open space inside the mill. It was a clarification. It was very famous in all the Marathi press, the clarification. This was an interpretation of the law by Ramanand Tiwari, which completely cut down from, if you took 1/3 of 600 acres and divided that, 100 acres should have come to the textile workers, 200 acres totally should have gone for public housing, and 200 acres should have come to the city to create green lungs. Right? So this was struck down because of this interpretation, against which civil society, including environmental groups in Mumbai, supported by workers and all kinds of civil society groups, went to court. While the case was in High Court, Mr. Arun Jaitley, Mr. Soli Sorabji, Mr. what's his name? Abhishek Singhvi, all three were hired by the mill owners. They went to Supreme Court and said, we do not trust the High Court because the High Court will probably support the civil society of Mumbai. Take the case away from them and bring it to Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said it is not possible under law. Don't worry, let them finish. They did that. Let them finish means the High Court gave an order in favor of the city. It immediately went to Supreme Court and it was struck down, because they said that you cannot take away land of the mill owners. They did not bother to look at the fact that this land was not really mill owners. It's leased land. They did not go into any of those details. It was gone, that case. Okay, that's just one of the things, because just to show how fair our Supreme Court is, because it's nowadays judicial activism and Supreme Court become very hero-like in everybody's eyes. But okay, so now the workers' housing. The workers have got a part of the land. So to date, the houses that have been built on mill lands, 6,948 houses in the first phase have been built and distributed. Second phase, 2,634 apartments. The price is, there is a price to this. It is not free. 7.5 lakhs for the work, have to be, but the loans were provided by government, and at a very small interest rate they had to give the money back. But the cost of that, unfortunately, the market again defeats us, because the market rate of those properties are over 60 lakhs, so the temptation to sell is very high. But anyway, so in the suburbs, the area is a little bigger. There are 2,500 houses built, and all, anyway, totally about 20,000 houses are been built. But the total number of workers who have filled the forms is 1.5 lakhs. The current government, we have gone through 5 governments so far. Now the Fadnavis government, they have said that they are still looking at land. That process is still continuing. The struggle continues. All I want to say at the end is the struggle of the textile workers is still continuing. And that is the important thing. And it is not a struggle of a union anymore. It is like a social movement. It's like a people's movement. And that struggle has been conducted not just by workers, but also by a large number of people, city activists, urban activists, who have also been part of this struggle. So it's a complex struggle. I've not been able to encapsulate all the issues that are part of this. But I will leave it to Datta, since we are doing this session together, to talk about the struggle per se. Datta.